Welcome to Modern Medicine with Dr. Moylan. This is an ongoing series in which we hope to educate the public on topics that are important not only to public health, but the cutting edge of medical science. And today I have as my guest Mr. Jim Nettles. Jim, welcome to Modern Medicine.
Thank you, Doctor.
Well, I first met you at the coroner's course in the State Police Academy in Hershey in 2011, right before I took office. At that point, you were the chief deputy coroner in the Schuylkill County.
Yes, that's correct.
And I was impressed with you from day one, and I'm so glad that you decided to stay on and work with us in the last 2.5 years.
I appreciate the offer.
Can you bring us up to date on your other activities in the county?
Well, at present time, I'm employed as the chief of police at Foster Township. I'm a retired state trooper with almost 31 years as a police officer. So I've been involved in the administration of justice field for many years, investigations, drug activities, and just routine police investigations.
Well, I also know that you're an educator. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, I do. I teach classes at McCann. I teach criminal justice classes. Majority of them are from the criminal law, the business law, to security, to various criminology. Most of your criminal justice classes I do teach. I've been at McCann just about 10 years.
Great. Well, this past April, we had our ongoing forensic science course here at the Simon Kramer Cancer Institute. It was approved by the Attorney General's Office for continuing education credits for coroners and chief deputy coroners. You gave, I'm going to say, a magnificent presentation, a very enlightening presentation on the problem with narcotics. And I've invited you here this evening to discuss that and enlighten us on that and give us some advice on how we can stem this epidemic. And appropriately, you've called your talk, "There is a Killer Out There."
That's correct. That's the program I put together for your program in April. And it seemed to go over well. A lot of people did get some information from it. And I also received some information from individuals that were attending the program.
So, well, why don't we walk through some of the slides here, and if you could comment from a law enforcement perspective, and I may add some thoughts from a medical perspective.
Okay. Basically, my presentation was there's a killer out there, and I identified it as heroin, because we do have an epidemic in the county, as you well know. Our problem right now is that we have fentanyl. And fentanyl basically is we have identified our basic killer as fentanyl. That's heroin mixed with the fentanyl that we're seeing within the county and throughout the basically United States.
Well, Jim, heroin never was licensed for pain control in the United States, never. Although in England, it was once an approved drug. But this fentanyl that you mentioned, I've been working with that for 25 years, and it became available to us as the patch, the pain patch. Right. And it was great for cancer patients that couldn't swallow or that weren't reliable as far as taking their medicine on a schedule. So you would slap a patch on them, and it would release the chemical fentanyl into their bloodstream 24 hours a day. So it was a wonderful tool to have to treat cancer patients.
And as a result, though, a lot of the individuals that are drug dependent have misused that particular patch. And my instructions go on with heroin. I put together, where does it come from? A lot of people had no idea.
I found this part of your presentation particularly stimulating because I'm kind of a history buff, and you touched upon the history of the poppy plant.
And it does come from the opium poppy plant. Your plant produces a seed pods. They cut incisions into the seed pod, and then you get a white milky fluid that oozes out. And this basically hardens into a dark brown gum, and that's raw opium. And this gum is collected. And how they go about doing this is that the raw cooked opium basically contains about 35 plus alkaloids, various chemicals within a substance, and which is morphine and codeine. And to extract the morphine from the opium, you get heroin. And how they do this is they process, they dissolve the opium in boiling water, they add lime, calcium oxide, or limestone. They process the non-morphine alkaloids, and they pour off the morphine in a solution of ammonium chloride and add it to it.
Jim, it sounds like you almost need to be a chemistry major to be putting this stuff together.
And unfortunately, most of this information is on the web. And that's the unfortunate part of it. And as a result of this, you get morphine from your solution. And this conversion of morphine to heroin basically is simple and inexpensive. And one chemical in the compound is basically, it's almost like a pungent odor, it's vinegar. It's an irritant and inflammable liquid. And this vapor is very harmful when they're doing this particular process.
Does it contain enough of the chemical for them to get inebriated or high on those vapors? Or?
Oh, yes.
You know?
Yes, the vapors are very harmful. One thing about heroin, it's about 2.5 times as potent as morphine. And why? Because it penetrates the blood-brain barrier and converts back into morphine. And as with heroin, pure heroin is white powder. It has a bitter taste, little odor, can smell like vinegar. The street heroin is in different forms and colors. The heroin is either a salt or a base. And the salt dissolves in water and is best to inject or for them to sniff. Now the base is best to smoke, must be mixed to dissolve. They can add acid or vitamin C. And the brown heroin is basically your base. And heroin basically, when diluted, is called stepped on. And you may hear that terminology from various people on the streets. And it's cut with anything that will dissolve when heated. Lactose, quinine, flour, cornstarch, baking soda. So there's many ingredients that they could use to dilute their heroin with.
Well, Jim, when I first came into the field 20, 30 years ago, there was a lot of problems that were seen from a cardiology perspective. And I think it was related to what they were cutting it with. And these particles, lactose, cornstarch, they would end up in the bloodstream and would damage the heart valves. And you could see that when the heart valve had to be taken out or replaced. So that's kind of the pathology of it. We're going to take a 1 minute break here and as we move along. Welcome back to Modern Medicine with Doc Moylan. Our guest is Jim Nettles, who is giving us a presentation on heroin as a killer. Jim?
Thank you, Doctor. We were just discussing how basically it was synthesized with heroin, but heroin has various street names, and it's from different locations. It can be known by many different terminology: smack, big H, brown sugar, horse, junk, black tar, dope, mud, scat. And there's probably many other names that we're not even familiar with that there's called on the street.
Are any of them particular to our region?
To be honest with you, they all know those names.
Yeah.
And a lot of them invent their own names for a particular region. So when you're doing investigation, you may not even come up with one of these names, something else will come out. And you're always adding new names to how they the terminology for the heroin on the street.
It's almost like the bath salts. You have to stay one step ahead of them because they're always changing.
Correct.
But some of these titles that they have here, they're related to the color or the consistency of the crude product?
That's correct. Yeah. And a little bit of history of the of heroin. It's not a new drug that showed up in the 1960s. It's an opium derivative which served severe physical, mental dependencies. And some of the birth of this American heroin addict, how did this occur? In the 1800s, the opium was proper drug that came to America, as you know, with the being a history buff, with the Chinese immigrants that came to work on the railroads. And with them, they brought this opium product with them. And they established what to be known as Chinatowns. And with the establishment of these Chinatowns came what we call opium dens. And they were all over, a lot of them out in the Midwest. And this is a situation here. We all pictured cowhands belly up at a bar in a Western or drinking whiskey. In reality, he was not belly up at the bar, but he may have been in a prone position in a room smoking opium with Oriental prostitutes, sometimes spending days at a time in these dens. And a lot of their time and money was in these opium dens.
And this kind of relates to the old saying or the aphorism of a pipe dream.
Correct. And one of the things that, as you know, Doctor, back in those days, in the 1800s, alcoholism was a bigger problem in those days, causing violence and death. But what did they come up with for a cure for alcoholism? And you guessed it, it's opium.
Well, Jim, I was at another conference over in Monroe County. Bob Allen put together one, he had a speaker there. And that pathologist was emphasizing that withdrawal from alcohol, that can kill you.
Yes.
It puts the heart into fatal arrhythmias and everything. The withdrawal from the narcotics, you want to be dead, but it usually doesn't have the fatal consequences of the withdrawal from alcohol.
It was just
interesting.
And it was just, I guess it was just amazing what the cure-alls they came up with for these various diseases, if you call alcoholism a disease, and here you come up with opium. Mm-hmm. And in the 1980s, again, we had in 1810, we had morphine, derivative of opium, was developed as a painkiller, considered a wonder drug. And this German pharmacist poured liquid ammonia over opium, producing a white powder morphine. And 10 parts of opium refined into one part of morphine.
So really a more concentrated form.
Yes.
And you alluded to how much more concentrated heroin is.
Yes.
Compared to morphine. So it keeps
Two
getting more powerful.
More powerful. And again, we had, with your history, there was two opium wars. And I'll just give you a brief. In 1839, we had the Chinese basically wanted to stop the importing of opium into their country. And in the port of Canton, they confiscated and destroyed basically all the opium that was waiting to be offloaded. The British merchants at that time want compensation. The results was a war with British routing the Chinese, and they were forced to pay $6 million for the amount of damage that they did at that particular time.
So here the Chinese are trying to protect their population from drug traffickers, basically.
Because at that point, they knew that they had an epidemic on their hand because of the trade wars that were going on.
Yeah. Well, and the British Empire was noted for such activity. You know, the Irish can tell you about that. But again, it goes back to might makes right.
Yes. And as a result of this particular in 1839, the result was Hong Kong became a crown colony, and the British continued shipping tons of opium to China. Many Chinese became addicts. Morphine was promoted basically by a lot of your missionaries as an agent for detoxification of opium addicts. So as a result, you were...
Well, we kind of are doing the same thing in the modern era with methadone. It was sold as a way of getting people off the hard stuff, you know?
Yes.
But Jim, where were they getting the opium at that point? Where were the British getting it to take over to Canton or Hong Kong?
Basically, a lot of it basically came from Afghanistan and those countries at that time, Turkey. There was a lot of trades going back and forth for their goods, for their particular goods they had, and the British was using those and as a trade-off for their drugs and for their wares, the Chinese wares. And the second one was in a second war was 1856, and with the Chinese government attempted to stop the spread of opium, result was that Russia, United States, and France wanted trade of opium. British and French warships, they sacked the city of Canton, and a commission was appointed to legalize and regulate the opium trade. You can see how that ended up with that particular war.
Okay. All right. Well, I think now might be we're pretty much going through the history of the trade. We'll take a break, go to a commercial, and we can pick up where we left off. Modern Medicine with Doc Moylan. We have a fascinating presentation today regarding the history of narcotics, not only in the United States, but throughout the world. Our guest is Jim Nettles, who has an extensive background in law enforcement and education. Jim, why don't you pick up where we left off on the history?
Thank you, Doctor. And as we were talking about the opium wars, but in 1850s, we had the morphine became popular with the medical profession. And morphine tablets were available. And you didn't need a prescription back then for these tablets they were handing out. In 1853, we came up with the hypodermic syringe. And American doctors began using the syringe as a means to inject morphine into their patients.
Well, just a commentary here, and you know, this is a technological advance. Same thing happened with cigarettes, tobacco.
Yes.
It was, you know, you smoke a pipe, but it wasn't until they invented the cigarette rolling machine that the addiction exploded. And the reason for wanting to be able to inject it, morphine is poorly absorbed by mouth, but we do use it for cancer pain, slow release morphine, but it takes about 3 to 6 times the dose by mouth to have the same effect as 10 milligrams injected into a muscle, say on a battlefield, a soldier has broken a leg or something, you give it to him, so it's released immediately, versus pills takes hours and hours.
Okay, and another event that occurred was the Civil War, when we had tens of thousands of the Northern and Confederate soldiers became morphine addicts, because basically what was going on, the U.S. was plagued with a major morphine epidemic after the war. And to treat their wounds, as you were just speaking of, hypodermic kits were passed out to many soldiers. And a lot of them, as they were being wounded or whatever, were injecting themselves into and receiving this particular drug. And another fact that occurred is in the 1870s, women were injected to numb pain of female problems. And as a result of that, in the 1890s, the first drug epidemic peaked. The females became medical addicts, and one half of all addicts incredible. That we had in the country.
That's incredible.
And in 1874, again, this is that British chemist who synthesized morphine, most powerful of the opiates.
What has impressed me in our work for toxicology for our drug overdose decedents is the metabolites that we look for. And of course, this is the morphine is, or the heroin is the diacetylmorphine. It's only around for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and then it's converted to the monoacetyl morphine. That's only around for, half hour or so. So oftentimes we're tracking these metabolites and they can be in and out of the system, and but that's what killed the person.
And in 1874, basically everyone thought that we came up with the answer to this epidemic that we created. They came up with a new wonder drug that was invented in Germany. This is the birth of heroin, which was imported to the United States. And the sales pitch basically was that it instant market to American doctors that heroin was a safe, non-addicted substitute for morphine. Now we have the heroin addict was born at this particular time because of this the amounts that were coming into the United States.
Well, Jim, in modern times, the analogy to that would be the OxyContin.
Right.
The drug company kind of pitched that as that this was going to be much less addicting. Sure didn't turn out that way. And the FDA, Federal Drug Administration, came down on that particular manufacturer with big penalties, and they had their executives placed in jeopardy. So,
and in 1898, we had the Bayer Pharmaceutical Company that launched their new pill, trade name heroin, right on the bottle. It was marketed as a sedative for coughs, and the opiates, morphine and heroin, really were readily available in the United States basically and up until 1914.
The First World War.
Yes. And from 1800s to the early 1900s, drug companies manufactured over-the-counter drug kits. And these kits contained a glass barrel hypodermic needle with vials of opiates, either morphine, coke, or heroin, and sometimes cocaine. And then also you had these, if I'm pronouncing it right, landrium, basically yeah. It's opium in a alcohol base. It was a popular elixir treating a variety of ills, kids and adults, as freely as aspirin and used today. And the heroin, basically, morphine, unregulated and sold legally until the 1920s. And then they passed the Dangerous Drug Act. And by the time the law was passed, it was a little bit too late. Mm-hmm. The market for heroin was created in 1925, estimated 200,000 people were heroin addicts in this country.
Well, not that long ago, as I said, when I first started my career in medicine, they came up with a tincture of opium, and that was a remedy for diarrhea. And you can't get it anymore, but it worked very well.
And another fact is we had an excellent chance that heroin addiction could be eliminated in the United States, and this came about in World War II. This dramatic impact was on the supply to U.S. Japanese, basically, invasion of China interrupted all these supplies going back and forth. And the German submarines were in the shipping routes and reducing the amount of heroin from Turkey to Marcellus to the United States. And as a result of that, the war made smuggling to the United States virtually impossible at this particular time during the war. But the U.S. never followed up. By the 1980s, an estimated 500,000 Americans used heroin. Mostly poor, at that time, mostly poor young minority men and women in the inner cities. Another fact is that for decades, heroin basically was trafficking to the United States, controlled by a lot of organized crimes families. And drug trafficking network known as the French Connection, and I know being a history buff, you probably saw this movie many times.
Yeah.
And
Gene Hackman.
That's correct.
And I did some work up in Poughkeepsie some years back, but that was one of the lines. What are you doing? Picking your toes in Poughkeepsie.
Yes. And the French sailors at that time from Marcellus were downshipping heroin directly to the United States, which was distributed by the mafia families to our street dealers. And by 1972, the French and the U.S. drug agents then dismantled the French connection, you know, ending mafia's monopoly on heroin.
Jim, I think this is a good place to break, because we've gotten the history lesson up to the French connection, and now we're going to be starting a new chapter, and that's the Colombians.
Okay.
To our guests, I want to thank you for your attention for this fascinating presentation that Jim Nettles is sharing with us, and there's more to learn here, so please stay tuned for a further episode. Thank you.